book of Ruth, chapter 4. And what we're reading first and foremost, verses 13 to 18. I want to speak to you this morning on the title, The Blessing of Perseverance. The Blessing of Perseverance. Can somebody say praise the Lord this morning? The Blessing of Perseverance. It says, so Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. Then he went to her, and the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. The women said to Naomi, and I hope you see that. The women said to Naomi, praise be to the Lord, who this day has not left you without a kinsman redeemer. May he become famous throughout Israel. He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age. For your daughter-in-law who loves you and who is better to you than seven sons. Can I read that again this morning? For your daughter-in-law who loves you and is better to you than seven sons has given you birth. Then Naomi took the child, laid him in her lap, and cared for him. Obed, he was the father of Jesse, and cared for him. It says, the women living there said, Naomi has a son. And they named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. This then is the family name of Perez. Father, this is your word, and you promised that it would never return to you, Father. I pray that it will achieve all that you intend for it to achieve today. And we give you continually in this place all the honor and all the glory and all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Beloved, I greet you this morning in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God is indeed a great God, and he's wonderful to be praised. On All Year's Night, and for the first three Sundays in January, I've been focusing on this book of Ruth. As the Spirit of God speaks to us as an assembly, but more importantly as individuals, those of us who are blessed with a good memory would remember that on the first Sunday of December last year, Sister Sherry Ann Steers in the song area dealt beautifully with the whole issue of the kinsman redeemer. And therefore, I did not touch that all important aspect of the book of Ruth. We look in the past at the motivation for the trip to Moab. We look at the resulting consequences. We look at the journey back and some of the happenings that took place following there, Ruth and Naomi's return. In my last part, we look at the whole aspect of sanctification, getting oneself clean before an Almighty God. I also, in the last sermon, placed some emphasis on Esther's experience. It is said by commentators, and I didn't even mention it at the time, but commentators say to us that when Esther's purification process was finished, it was as though Esther's skin was polished. Praise God. Now we know Esther was a beautiful young lady. But when the purification process was finished, the writer said that Esther's body shined, looked like it had been polished. Praise God. And it says to us that we need to get clean before God. David Guzik, in his usual word commentary, he says, Esther was beautiful to begin with. Now she looked like one of those after pictures from the glamour for the studios. And she looked that way all the time. Praise God. There was an author by the name of F.B. Union, and he said, the ancient Hebrew word for beauty preparations comes from the root of to stir or to polish. As I speak to you this morning on the subject stated, the blessings of perseverance, I want to challenge you never to give up too quickly when things seem as though they're going against you. Are you hearing me this morning? We have to get to a place where we prepare ourselves to expect the unexpected. The ultimate Almighty God made us in such a way that we are able to withstand the difficulty. It's so amazing. And no doubt you see it sometimes on the news when anchors from CNN and Fox News and these different places, when there's a terrible hurricane, you will see those persons out in the wind. And sometimes they're struggling, but the wind never snaps them in half. But as they're standing there, you will sometimes see a sun flying past them, snapped by the wind. God has built into our DNA the ability to last, amen, even in the strongest of winds, amen. Ruth may not have been able to imagine the future that is now a reality, given all that had taken place. So this morning, very quickly, there are just a few things I want to challenge you with, but I pray in the name of Jesus that you will spend some time in this little book, and that you will allow the Spirit of God to minister to you, even from the portions that I may not have been able to touch. Amen? The first thing I want to say to you this morning is that so many times, harvest begins with famine. Harvest begins with famine. And what does that mean? It means sometimes in order for you to go on to a period of blessing in your life, there is always seemingly a period of struggle. A period when if you're not careful, you will have given up. Because most times you don't know what God has in your future. You don't know. But you only do know if you stay around long enough. In Genesis chapter 12 and verse 10, the Bible says that after God asked Abraham to leave his family home and to go to a promised land, the Bible tells us that there was a severe famine. The Bible says that Abraham turned and went into Egypt. He lied or he created the lie on his way there. And out of that very experience of deceitfulness, the Bible tells us then in Genesis chapter 13 and verse 1 that when Abraham and who he was with came out of Egypt, he went in a period of famine. But the Bible said that praise God, as a result of one instant of deceit. Now, I'm not saying to be deceitful to anybody. Amen. Praise God. In Genesis chapter 26, verse 1 to 6, and then in verse 12, Isaac has found himself again in a period of famine. And Isaac Secondly, this morning, I want us to understand that in the midst of those circumstances, sometimes God is getting ready to birth a blessing. A blessing so tremendous that sometimes you cannot even contain it. That is one of the things that is evident from the two families that came earlier. Therefore, how do we know when God is even in whatever we are going through? And truly, we have to come to a place where we become sensitive to the voice of and His leading. This was the essence of what Minister Sonia Norris dwelled on when she was here a few Sundays back. Coming to the place where you become so sensitive to the Spirit of God. And I want to say something to you this morning. God is concerned with the smallest detail of your life. How do you know when it is the voice of God? Because there are certain things, and if you're going through a situation in your life, and the solution to break free of that drops into your spirit, and what what is also evident is that God's road to success, hear me this morning, God's road to success, not as the world needs it, but it will often lead you through treacherous paths, over hills and down into valleys, and more often than not, if you do not
reported that when Roosevelt got off the ship, there was this
and author of America's Pastor, People who didn't like the degree spent a lot of time trying to find personal violations of his moral and ethical code, and they couldn't find it. Back to NPR after Green's passing, they didn't exist. He was a man who maintained absolute market fidelity and moral and financial integrity. He was an evangelist who lived the way which praise God. Praise God. And then finally this morning, the resulting blessing. Verses 80-22 says to us, Perez was the father of Hezron. Hezron the father of Ram. Ram the father of Amminadab. Amminadab the father of Nashon. Nashon the father of Salmon. Salmon the father of Boaz. Boaz the father of Obed. Obed the father of Jesse. And Jesse the father of David. Beloved, this story of experience is now culminated in what I believe was the marriage of a lifetime. Also, I also believe that Ruth could never imagine in her wildest dreams that she would not only marry again, but that her future is going to be as blessed as it's going to be. God is here, preparing a virtuous woman from an enemy nation, hear me this morning, from an enemy nation to propel us through. When I view situations like these, I usually ask myself, now God, if with all the beautiful women within Israel, if you couldn't find one of them, they will go, and he's bestowing upon us. And it says to us that